welcome. You're watching NewsX and I'm Megha Sharma. Now, hours after being named as the BJP Maharashtra Chief Minister pick, Devendra Fadnavis has staked claim to form a government in the state. He's slated to take oath as the Chief Minister of the state in the presence of Prime Minister Narendra Modi tomorrow. Sources suggest that Eknath, Shinde and Ajit Pawar will be sworn in as the Deputy Chief Ministers tomorrow at the Azad Maidan in Mumbai. Mahayuti's landslide victory secured them a whopping 235 seats in these elections. Meanwhile, for the first time in 6 decades, the Maha Vikas Aghadi parties were left with insufficient number of seats to secure the position of the leader of opposition. Aditya Thackeray won by a very slim margin against Milind Deora, and the Congress leaders like Prithviraj Chauhan suffered an embarrassing loss, prompting reprimands from the Congress President Mallikarjun Kharge and Rahul Gandhi. Will the Mahayuti be able to run a stable government for the next 5 years? And if so, what does that leave for Shiv Sena's Uddhav Thackeray faction, for Sharad Pawar and for Supriya Sule, as well as the Congress in Maharashtra in the road ahead? Let's start our conversation. Joining me on the telecast is Tejas Mehta. He is a senior journalist. Tejas, thanks for joining me. And first things first, there is going to be a meeting that is scheduled to be held today at 7 p.m., which will have the Mahayuti leaders as well as the BJP state in charges, including Nirmala Sitaraman and Vijay Rupani, who will be holding that closed door meeting. Tomorrow is the swearing in ceremony where Devendra Fadnavis will be taking oath as the Chief Minister. The only area of discrepancy is that Eknath Shinde has still not confirmed that he is ready to take that seat of the Deputy Chief Minister that has been proposed by Mahayuti led by BJP. Do you think there could be some last minute twist that could be witnessed?
Well, absolutely unlikely given the press conference which took place. One of the clips has really gone viral and I tweeted about it, where you are seeing the question being posed to Eknath Shinde was that will he and Ajit Pawar, along with Devendra Fadnavis be sworn in tomorrow as a Deputy Chief Minister. Now, Eknath Shinde answered that question several times, but the reporter wanted the answer in Hindi. So he asked him, and Eknath Shinde, very, as politicians generally do, was diplomatic and said, listen, election, this thing is tomorrow, so let's wait till the evening and then we will see. Anyway, the swearing in ceremony is tomorrow. In between all of that, you had Ajit Pawar, stepping in and saying, see, he may decide until tomorrow, until the evening, but I am sure I am getting sworn in. So it's very clear, and everybody was laughing, and then the banter went on. That this whole thing, it showed two things. Actually, when you ask whether these two allies will support the BJP or not, I have almost no doubt, because these three leaders are, they're very extremely grounded leaders. Both Devendra Fadnavis, Eknath Shinde and Ajit Pawar, and they know what is at stake here. First of all, politically, their political well-being and survival is when you are in power, especially for smaller regional parties. And now with the NCP, divided and Sena divided into two, the pie is much smaller for each party. So they have somebody like the BJP holding hand, and they would not really mind. They would go along with them. And remember, there are within Maharashtra, there are municipal elections, there are panchayat elections. So there is a lot at stake here. They are in the center. Now, of course, all this, during a period like this, we'll always see positioning and posturing by politicians, yeah, because this is part of the negotiation. You show I'm ill, you show that, I'm not, I'm upset about what's really happening. But at the end of the day, the seasoned politicians do understand how much they can extract from the bigger party. And this is how all negotiations work. He is asking for the Chief Minister's post. Because he asked for that, now he is not going to be given that. He'll be given probably, finance or home. May not be home, but maybe finance or any other plum portfolios, as politicians would like to call. So, this is all part of negotiation and bargaining. I don't think this is real politics. I think they are seasoned politicians. Okay. So, I do believe he will be sworn in as Deputy Chief Minister. In fact, sources have already from the party told the media that he will be sworn in along with Devendra Fadnavis and Ajit Pawar as the next Deputy Chief Minister of Maharashtra.
Okay,
though,
all right,
remember,
all right, fair enough.
There is
okay,
no
so
position
him,
as
yeah, Himanshu,
Deputy
but
Chief
again,
Minister.
Again, a response from you with regards to how the situation has played out. Again, you know, these tactics are largely being seen as you know, having a leverage, you know, pressure politics at play. Perhaps if there's a tantrum thrown, if there is you are not available, your pretend that you are sick, and are talking about how till the last minute you are going to keep the public guessing whether you pick the Deputy Chief Minister's post. Again, a tussle over here for the portfolios. Who gets the plum positions is the question.
Okay, Megha, let me tell you, first things first, if you heard the press conference totally, what Eknath Shinde said in Marathi was very, very clear. He said 2.5 years ago, it was Devendra Fadnavis who supported me to be Chief Minister. And now it's my turn to support him. And we from Shiv Sena have given that letter to the Rajyapal. Now that settles so many things. Then he said another thing, you know, in Marathi, he was talking in Marathi, so many people could not understand. But you know, what I gathered was, he said, 2 days, 2 din mein bahar kyun gaya? Main gaon gaya, when I went to my village, media started talking so many things. Now that was very, very indicative. He was trying to suggest that there was absolutely no rift. And let me remind you, some 12, 13 days ago, Eknath Shinde himself has said, for a small matter of a chief ministership, we will not break the Mahayuti. We are not Uddhav Thackeray. That was very significant. So when you put all these things together, and
but also what choice does he have?
What
choice does he really have? Even if he were to break away from Mahayuti, and if NCP were to,
I'm coming to that.
It's better to be the Deputy Chief Minister than to get nothing really.
No. See, when he was a Chief Minister, he had urban development portfolio. He will continue to have so when he's a Deputy Chief Minister. Home was with Devendra Fadnavis during last 2.5 years also, when he was a Deputy Chief Minister. He will continue to have home department. Similarly, with Ajit Dada Pawar, he had finance, and he will continue to have finance. So there are absolutely no doubts in my mind that tomorrow by 5:30, all three of them will be sworn in for their post. Now, when you come to that, what choices did he have? Actually, you must talk of the mandate which the BJP got is very, very clear. If they are alone, still they can rule. Some people might say, how? They have just 132. But they already have 6 people from the smaller parties and independents already supporting them. The another thing, when you ask the question, what will happen to Sarath Pawar and Supriya Sule and Uddhav Thackeray? What will happen to Uddhav Thackeray is, he will find it very, very difficult to keep his flocks of 20 together. They, because so many of them want to go back to the ideology of Hinduism through which they have brought themselves up and nurtured themselves up. In such a scenario, I don't foresee, you know, the support not being there and all other people together will form another, you know, party, another government, and BJP will be out. BJP will rule for full 5 years, whether these people, Eknath Shinde, Shiv Sena, or Ajit Pawar, NCP, supports them or not. That I am very clear.
Okay.
And
okay.
Eknath Shinde and Ajit Pawar are not very good friends. Let me tell you that.
Okay, all right. I mean, let's have a word with Rajalakshmi Joshi as well. We talked about, you know, the winning side, the Mahayuti, the mega celebrations at the oath-taking ceremony that will take place tomorrow. But on the flip side, what is happening to the losing side? Congress has been the worst performer. It was a junior party when the Maha Vikas Aghadi came into power. And talking about some of its veterans, the likes of Prithviraj Chavan, you know, debacle for him. I mean, he could not even retain the seat that he had consecutively been winning for several terms. And then we talk about Sharad Pawar's NCP. Instead of getting support of the people, and this is again, you know, a power play. Here you have the OG, who is the supremo, who's the founder of the NCP, and there you have the nephew who has broken away, and it seems as if the tide is swaying in favor of the nephew and not Sharad Pawar. So that also brings about, you know, the precarious nature of which Supriya Sule will have to face, who's the successor, the direct ascendant of Sharad Pawar, who's going to take forward that party. Is that coming to extinction at this point of time? Also talking about Shiv Sena, that is led by Uddhav Thackeray, again, as was spoken by Himanshu Bhatt, you know, a flock of a mere 20 of those MLAs. How difficult is it going to be for Shiv Sena, Uddhav Thackeray, to stay in relevance today?
Good evening, Megha. Thank you for having me on your show. You know, very firstly, let me mention Mr. Uddhav Thackeray. Even though his numbers probably didn't seem as bad as of Congress, I would say that he today must be feeling like the biggest loser, because he was in the coalition with the BJP in the past couple of governments. He had actually fought in alliance, and even before that also, from quite so many years, you know, they have been in a natural alliance with the BJP. And in the last two elections, in the last two Vidhan Sabha elections, he has shown a little bit of dissent, and there were some differences. Yes, but I'm sure that they could have been ironed out, for sure, that was definitely possible. But now today what has happened is, he has not only lost his own party, he has gone away from his ideology, and today he has had to eat his own words. He has now gone back to the his own party men, saying that now we are going to fight the next elections on the plank of Hindutva. Let's go back to our Hindutva. So that is how, you know, he has had to literally make a U-turn of sorts, where he kept his mouth shut when even all the ulemas were saying that all the Muslims should be voting for the MBA, otherwise you will be banished from being a Muslim. And all these kind of things, he kept his mouth shut, and he went completely against his own ideology. And I think that today he must be really feeling like a very sore loser. And so it is going to be extremely difficult for him to hold on to whatever few numbers of MLAs he has, MLAs as well as MPs. You know, we keep hearing so many stories about so many people approaching the BJP and approaching Eknath Shinde about getting back to this, the Mahayuti.
Okay.
So that is how
okay.
to stand with the Shiv Sena.
Okay.
Now coming
right.
to the Congress, Megha, the Congress, you can see, is on the way out in almost all states. So, you know, initially, there was this situation, you know, in the initial few years after independence, where other parties had a problem finding the leader of opposition. Now, today, the Congress is in that kind of a situation. And sadly, because they keep going back to the people with the same narratives, they don't learn their lessons. See, just look at how in the Lok Sabha elections, they were the best performers, and it took them no time to become the worst performers. And the BJP, which did fairly badly in the Lok Sabha, they did a lot of course correction, and look at how they have completely swayed the elections in their favor. So that is how, that is a complete difference between the Congress and the BJP.
Okay,
now, coming
all right,
to the
I'm
NCP,
to, I'll come back to you, I'll come back to you. Let's also talk about the NCP, but just a moment. Advocate
yes.
Manasvi Thapar, I'm going to come to you. And when that very caustic comment comes from Mallikarjun Kharge, who absolves the party high command of the loss that Congress has once again witnessed in the Maharashtra elections, and puts the onus on the Congress Maharashtra leaders. Now, who are these Congress Maharashtra leaders? Because there is a massive lacune of who is going to take the Congress forward in Maharashtra. Prithviraj Chavan doesn't look like a likely option. Ashok Chavan has jumped ship and gone to Mahayuti. You take a look at what happened to Milind Deora. He's also decided to switch sides. There is no face for the Congress to rely on at least in Maharashtra, let's not even talk about the other states, but in Maharashtra, there is nobody who can actually take forward the Congress.
Precisely, when it is very natural also when there is a side which is continuously losing its ground, there are going to be leaders which were supposedly one of those leaders who were incubated by the Congress in their political party and gave them all the positions then. And when the Congress party is losing, these are people who have switched ships. And I think there is nothing wrong. That's the human psychology, how it works. On the contrary, BJP has been working very strongly in the politics of Maharashtra, specifically speaking, be it from the support from the center and also the kind of nurturing of the local leaders they have done. And not only that, the BJP has worked in two ways. One way which they have worked out is that they have developed their party at the local level, at the booth level. Other thing which they have done is they have made sure that the other regional political parties of Maharashtra are broken into pieces, be it Shiv Sena, be it NCP. So that also have worked out in the favor of BJP and Congress also. So if we can't say that Congress didn't have leaders or don't have leaders. Congress have leaders. That's why BJP is accepting them. That's why BJP is open for taking those leaders which were once part of Congress with a different, completely different ideology. And today when they join BJP, they give them plum positions, they give them cabinets, they give them lots of other benefits, which BJP itself, they boycott their own karyakartas. When they outsource leaders from outside, what happens is there is a local level leader, there's a booth level leader who would aim to become a cabinet minister or a MLA or a MP in the future, in the long run. What happens when outsourced leaders come to a BJP, the future of these people get sabotaged in BJP. In the long run, that would be a problem. But as of now, as we say, everything is fair in love and war. Everything looks hunky-dory for BJP. They are winning election by election. The mandate is increasing. The vote share is increasing. So I don't think there is any scope which we can say that BJP is wrong.
No, but then they the situation again. If you turn it around, just it was just a few months ago that it was Eknath Shinde that had decided to break away from Shiv Sena, joined hands with the BJP. Mahayuti came into being. They formed the government. Eknath Shinde had the bigger say. He was made the chief minister. But here again, you see, BJP wins the larger number of seats, and that's how that's how politics plays out, or in fact that matter for any sphere. So therefore the chief minister is then handed over to the BJP leader, which is Devendra Fadnavis. And mind you, Devendra Fadnavis sacrificed that position for Eknath Shinde 2 years ago when the government was installed.
Allow me. So what happens here is, if we go historically in 1990s, 1980s, when BJP was trying to get inroads in Maharashtra, it was the Shiv Sena which compromised its own position, its own seat share, and gave it to BJP. It entered as a smaller brother, but now the things have changed and it came out as a bigger brother, compromised the... So what happens in Maharashtra? Hindutva Party is one political vote bank. So there are two political parties in Hindu-centric politics. So what happens is the vote has to be divided between the two parties. So what has been sabotaged is the vote share, the vote bank of Shiv Sena has been sabotaged so that the BJP could be accommodated at a larger numbers, larger seats. And BJP has done well. And BJP has done good in that particular segment. So there is no doubt about that. But what happens here in the future is, where is that Hindu vote? The Hindu vote is going to be shifted from Shiv Sena to BJP. So Shiv Sena is going to be decimated to further, or it would be a merger of Shiv Sena into BJP. That's where we would see in the next 5 years.
Are we actually saying that the Shiv Sena's existence from being a very strong regional party in Maharashtra under Balasaheb Thackeray is going to be in oblivion, going to disappear into oblivion? Can this really happen? Before I go to Tejas, I see Himanshu wants to make a point. Quickly, Himanshu. Yes.
Okay, basically, I would vouch for that. What you know, the statements this Manasvi made, to an extent, yes, but let B and C elections take place and you will exactly know what's happening to Shiv Shivasena. As far as Shiva Sena Uddhav Thackeray is concerned, their stronghold is BMC. And if they get routed over there, that will bring the death knell. Because then people have decided that we do not want anyone who has gone out of his ideology for some time to get votes off the other side and then coming back to us and talking about it. And as far as the leaders, imports of the leaders in BJP is concerned, let me tell you one thing, give you a very, very glaring statistics, Mega, that 85% of this import from Congress and other parties that contested in the BJP ticket, on the BJP ticket in Lok Sabha, have lost. And that's very clear indication for BJP by the people of India that we don't want such exports. And that's why, you know, if you listen to today's press conference, if you listen to, you know, Ajit Dada Pawar, what was he talking about? We have court cases. I have to go and meet my lawyer. He is made to accept that in public, that he's still being charged despite being deputy chief minister. That says a lots of things.
I really don't think that has any consequence whatsoever. I don't think court cases go on. There is going to be any sort of indictment or prosecution that happens against Ajit Pawar. Come on, we're talking about Ajit Pawar.
You take a look at the incumbent president Biden,
who has pardoned every single charge levied on his son Hunter Biden. So let's understand that's how politics function across. It's universal. I'm going to come back to you, Tejas. Yes, you want to make a point. Particularly, I want to focus on the legacy of Sharad Pawar. Has it faded? Is it now going to be ended with Sharad Pawar coming of age?
Well, I think his political career is, a very big comma, or you know, almost a full stop. Maybe that was if at all, you know, his health is in good shape, then he could still be active in the next 5 years, but 5 years, he has almost nothing to do now because Maharashtra elections and the national elections almost coincide. So for 5 years, what is he going to do? So I really don't, think he's going to, depending on his health, of course, what happens in the next 5 years. But until then, I don't think he has anything to, contribute nationally or in Maharashtra. They're completely routed. I think the danger lies to the smaller parties, the Shiv Sena, Uddhav Thackeray, UBT, and to Sharad Pawar. The Shiv Sena by itself is a very, very strong regional party. Let's not forget, it is not just about Hindutva. There is the Marathi connection, which is far more with Shiv Sena than compared to the BJP, which is seen as a national party. And secondly, this is on the legacy of Shivaji itself. So there is a lot of history behind that, the legacy of Balasaheb Thackeray. So I don't think simply you can, say, let's just get all these leaders and let's become one party. Even the BJP would not want to do that, because then somebody else will come and, occupy that space. Why? It's a separate space. Like in Tamil Nadu, you have, different factions representing different, the diverse populations. Same way in Maharashtra, you have different parties representing different, sections of society. And this is a very, very strong section. So I don't think the Shiv Sena will disappear. Yes, Maharashtra, Mumbai municipal election is going to be absolutely key. And that's what they're looking ahead. So tomorrow, I am pretty sure that Devendra Fadnavis will swear in with the other two. And I do believe, yes, you are right. The future of all both the smaller parties looks at the moment very, very bleak. Never say that this is the end of the political career.
Okay, all right. Rajalakshmi, you want to make a point about, looking forward, the five-year term for the Mahayuti looks as if it's sealed. There is likelihood of toppling of the governments, poaching of MLAs, perhaps not this time around with the strong mandate with which Mahayuti has come to power.
Yes, definitely. Mekha, those kind of fears are definitely unfounded. So they will. People have given a very strong mandate for a very stable government. So, like I was telling you earlier, that the BJP actually by itself could have formed the government with just a few MLAs from who are willing to actually support the BJP. So that was very easily possible. They don't need to forge anybody. So that was the kind of a situation. And now I also wanted to make a few quick points. I actually Manasvi spoke about how the BJP was not in existence as such. Yes, the BJP was not in existence when the Shiv Sena had started initially. But let me just remind him of one incident that, there was this young kid, there was this young boy who in Nagpur had refused to go to a school called as Indira Convent because his father, who was a Jan Sangh leader, he was jailed during the emergency by Indira Gandhi. So he refused to go to a school that had Indira Gandhi's name. And then he went to a school called Saraswati School. That kid grew up to become Devendra Fadnavis, who is today the Chief Minister of Maharashtra. So his father was a Jan Sangh leader, which has today transformed into the Bharatiya Janata Party. So the Bharatiya Janata Sangh was very much in existence in Maharashtra. In fact, that the RSS is definitely rooted in Nagpur. So the Bharatiya Janata Sangh was nowhere apart or away from the state
right.
of Maharashtra.
Right.
So you cannot say that, they did not have any existence. You have had stellar leaders like Pramod Mahajan, Gopinath Munde, Nitin Gadkari. All these leaders have been here, and they have been here much before Uddhav Thackeray.
Right,
they
have absolutely.
Been here from quite some time.
Yeah, okay.
So you can,
okay, fair enough.
Yes.
A closing comment from Advocate Manasvi Thapar. How do you look forward, particularly about what the strategy of the Congress, because I talk about the Congress because this is the grand old party. I talk about the Congress, which at one point of time had a very strong hold on Maharashtra. How do things move here on?
See, Congress as a political party, I don't think they would have a strategy as of now, because what the local leaders or the state leaders would believe, Congress is not a political party which will grow from the local leadership to the national leadership. It's a political party if the national performance is good, because they have a fixed vote bank. Even if they're decimated to such numbers, they have a vote bank since last 10 years while they're losing all elections year on year. Even then, people are still voting for Congress, and that's a good part for them. As a political party, as a political force, they have a 20%, 21% vote share, which is in their favor. What is happening is somehow the connection for the next 5-7% vote share is not there with them. That has to come from the national leadership. That has to come from a national charisma, which is missing from that X factor in politics, is missing from the Congress. If the national leadership is strong, if the national vote bank is consolidated, that would turn out into the local leadership. So
yeah, but then, that's what I'm saying. When the president of the Congress is blaming it on the local leaders, they're saying there are no local leaders to lead the party in Congress. And there you have it, you're giving a clean chit to your national, to the Gandhi Parivar, you're giving a clean chit to the party high command. Exactly, how does it function? One is reliant on the other, but you need to have a strong leadership, as you said, at the national level for the others to then emulate and follow.
See, in a 24/7 politics, which has come into existence after 2014 or in Gujarat before that also, while Prime Minister was the Chief Minister here, if you have an opponent as strong as Prime Minister Narendra Modi, who's into 24/7 politics, a political machinery, very well-oiled machinery, you have to function like him. You cannot be offbeat in politics because he's not offbeat. You can't sleep in politics because he's always awake, and there is a booth level management which is there, that has been developed by them since last 25 years. So you have to learn from them to defeat them. If you aim to defeat them, you have to learn, accept your mistakes, move on, and then only you can capture Maharashtra or the entire country if you want to be in politics, stable politics. Because your karyakarta's motivation goes down because you are losing year on year. You have to give them that X winning factor that, yes, we are coming up, we are with you. Leave for that matter that you are in Delhi.
And in the few states that you are winning the elections, you are not rewarding the people who are actually brought you to the position, to the numero uno position. There have been so many of these people who jumped ship from the Congress, talked about how we are put in a position that is only second class citizenry that is provided against the Gandhi. So to cull out all competition, allow for the Gandhi growth to happen, has also caused a lot of these disadvantages that the Congress at this point in time is facing.
One more more thing.
Quickly,
I think what we see in the next future of our country is that legacy politics is dead. There is no legacy politics which is going to continue in our country. It is not going to be personality cult. It is going to be issue based. That's what we are moving forward.
Okay.
There is any ideological.
I have a sentence for that.
In the Maharashtra election, it was ideology free election because BJP had both NCP, which is a completely different political ideology, Shiv Sena with them, and with Congress also there was Shiv Sena with them, NCP with them. So it was mixture of ideologies. But what was the winning factor was issues. I think now is the time in our country where issues will take the
center. Okay. Himanshu, yes, quickly, you know,
one
15
sentence,
seconds before I wrap this up.
Just one sentence from this year's politics. Jalebis are not made in factories is the fact that every Indian knows, every Bharatiya knows. And when a leader says that, well, you understand what happens to the party.
Okay. All right. On that note, I'm out of time. I thank all of you for joining me on the telecast. And I slip into a short break now. Thanks for watching NewsX.